Maybe we can start with a small kirtan, then we can get into the discussion of the module. Yeah. I do not know if I think, you know, most of the people have placed themselves on. Yeah. You're on mute.
People are encouraged to come themselves on the screen so that Prabhuji can see personally.
It would be good actually, you know, if all of you are on screen, and
it will be more personal than even all the Zoom.
Yeah. Yes. Anyways, I'll start. Jai Radha Madhav. Pranavallabhaya Girivaradhari Jaya Girivaradhari Jaya Shodhanandana Jaya Vajjanaranjana Jaya Vajjanaranjana Jaya Shodhanandana Jaya Vajjanaranjana Jaya Vajjanaranjana Vajjanaranjana Jaya Vajjanaranjana Jaya Jai Yamuna Tirvanchari Jaya Pandavihari Jai Yamuna Tirvanchari Jaya Pandavihari Hare Krishna Hare Krishna Krishna Hare Rama Hare Rama 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 Hare 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 Krishna 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 Hare 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 Rama 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 Ram Hare 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 Krishna Hare Krishna 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 Hare Hare Ram Hare Rama Rama Ram Hare 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 Krishna Hare Krishna 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 Hare Hare Ram Hare Rama Rama Ram Hare Hare Jaya Radha Madhava Jaya Kunja Bihara Hare Krishna 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 Hare 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 Ram Hare Ram 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 Hare Hare Krishna Hare Krishna 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 Hare 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 Ram Hare Ram 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 Hare Nityaya Rango Nityaya Rango Nityaya Rango Gaura Hari Nityaya Gaurango Nityaya Gaurango Nityaya Gaurango Gaura Hari Jai Satchinandana Jai Satchinandana Sachinandana Gaura Hari. Jai Sachinandana, Jai Sachinandana. Sachinandana Gaura Hari. Jai Radha Madan Mohan, Jai Radha Madan Mohan. Jai Radha Madan Mohan, Jai Radha Madan. Jai Radha Madan Mohan, Jai Radha Madan Mohan. Jai Radha Madan Mohan, Jai Radha Madan Mohan. Jai Jagannath, Jai Jagannath. Jai Jagannath Swami. Jai Baladeva, Jai Subhadra. Jai Baladeva, Jai Subhadra. Jai Baladeva, Jai Subhadra. Jai Baladeva, Jai Subhadra. Jagannath Swami, Jagannath Swami, Jagannath Swami, Jagannath Swami, Jagannath Swami, Jagannath Swami, नाम संकीर्तन की जय स्वप्रभुपाद की जय। ओम अज्ञातिमिरन्दस्य ज्ञानाञ्जनाशलाकया चक्षुर्मिलितमेन तस्मै श्रीगुरवे नमः। श्रीचैतन्यमनोभीष्टं स्थापितं येन भूतले स्वयं रूपकदामियं ददाति स्वपदान्तिकं पञ्चाकल्पतरुभ्यश कृपासिन्धुभ्यश्च पतितानां पावनेभ्यो वैष्णवेभ्यो नमो नमः। जय श्री कृष्ण चैतन्य प्रभु नित्यानंद श्री अद्वैत गदाधर श्रीवासादि गौर भक्तवृंद। हरे कृष्णा कृष्ण कृष्णा हरे हरे, हरे राम 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 हरे हरे। मोकं करोति वाचारं पंगुं लंघयते गिरिं यत्कृपातमहं वन्दे श्रीगुरुं दीनधारिणां। हरे कृष्ण एंड अ वेरी गुड मॉर्निंग टू वन एंड ऑल। Ideally, I would have been happy if you know some of you could have kept your video on. That's okay. Nonetheless, you know, I think you know we need to proceed with it. I'd like to you know start with this note that you know, nowadays you know, a lot of news is coming with respect to this IPL matches and all. So in the IPL matches, you know, if you see, you know, they start hitting from the beginning, but the last 5 hours are like you know very critical hours. Because you know that is the time actually it is a game changer. Last 5 hours are generally game changers. So they keep on hitting. They preserve the wickets till that time and they keep on hitting it. Because you know majorly if you see last 30 balls they'll be making somewhere about 55 to 60 runs or 70 runs based upon the kind of you know movement they're going. So similarly we can see in the Bhagavad Gita also the last 4 or 5 chapters are in a very critical chapters. Very critical chapters. Krishna directly comes to the point. Directly comes to the point that where actually a person is stuck up. In which mode of nature is stuck up. What is the mode of nature is operating in. How he has to be elevated. Directly to the point. He doesn't, you know, gets, you know, somewhere else. Directly. You know, it's very compassionate here. And because, you know, these are, you know, getting more condensed. Now we are at, you know, 16th chapter. 16th, 17th and 18th. They actually, you know, address directly to our heart only. We can actually more closely evaluate our heart based upon these chapters, especially starting from the 14th, which is speaks about the modes of the nature. Then comes 15th, then 16th is divine and demonic qualities, and 17th comes divisions of the faith, and the last one, which is there, the conclusion chapter. So this actually, you know, condensed form of the final teachings. So if you want to see the thrilling this thing, then thrilling one is these last chapters. So, with this introduction, I would like to start this particular module of 16th chapter, which is Divine and Demonic Qualities. So I thought, you know, I'll just, you know, start with a small presentation we have made, which makes you a little bit concentrated more, and the flow continues nicely. I hope you all are able to see the presentation.
Yes, yes, please.
Yeah. So primarily we can say that now this chapter is divided into three sections. One is the description of the divine nature, that is from verse 1 to 6. Then the verses 7 to 20 speaks about the characteristics or no description of the demonic qualities, which is close to our heart. And the last section, which is verse 21 to 24, it speaks about the three gates to hell and how can one avoid them. So this we should understand that now how actually we got implicated because of cultivating what kind of qualities and how actually we can overcome this. So in even from the in the verse like you know from 1 to 6, it is not entirely Krishna speaks about divine nature. Verse 4 actually Krishna speaks about demonic natures, but again 5th and 6th he speaks about slightly about you know divine natures. So now we'll just discuss, you know, what actually the divine qualities are. You know, if you say that, you know, somebody is enrolled with you know, divine qualities or you know, bodily qualities, what are these qualities actually? So these are the qualities which are there, like, you know, fearlessness, purification. So these qualities actually, you know, what Krishna has meant is that, you know, Chaturvarnyam, Maya system, Guna Karma Vibhagasa. So this Chaturvarnyam, Krishna creates the 4 Varnas and 4 Ashramas. I think, you know, in the previous discussions, you must have heard that there are 4 ashramas and 4 varnas. The 4 ashramas are like Brahmacharya ashram, Grahastha ashram, Vanaprastha ashram, Sannyasa ashram. That is ashramas. And varnas are there. That is, you know, Brahmana, Kshatriya, Vaishya, and Shudra. So these are the 4 varnas and ashramas which God himself has created. So it is not based upon the caste system. It is based upon the qualities and you know, the attributes, like, you know, the inbuilt instincts which actually you are gifted with when you are born and actually how you are cultivating them. So this is actually the way Lord has created this particular wonderful system of Vanashrama, where everybody is given an opportunity to explore their innate desires and talents in order to serve Krishna, serve the Lord. Important point is again the serve the Lord. The Vanashrama is meant for serving the Lord. So that is the main, serving the Lord Vishnu. So now when it comes to Vanashrama, so what the Lord has done is that, you know, every people, all these various, you know, people who are classified in this, you know, various Vanas and Ashrama, they should cultivate certain qualities which are required for them. So Prabhupada, what he does is that wonderfully he characterizes all these qualities into different Vanas and Ashramas. Like, you know, for example, if I go with the first one, that is a fearlessness, purification of one's existence, cultivation of spiritual knowledge. So Prabhupada says in his purpose, that now these three qualities are especially meant for the Sannyasa Ashram. So Sannyasa Ashram is like, you know, topmost in the entire Vanashrama system. Of all the Vanas and Ashramas, the topmost is Sannyasa Ashram. So they should be really fearless, because, you know, they should have the conviction that, you know, wherever I am placed, I will be protected by Krishna. Krishna will protect me. And they should, you know, keep their existence, you know, very pure. They should not be contaminated with any kinds of material desires. Because, you know, this is the ashrama which a person generally enters after, you know, getting, you know, properly purified through Brahmacharya ashram, Grahastha ashram, Vanaprastha ashram, then he gets into Sannyasa ashram, ideally. So one has to be, you know, thoroughly purified, and they should be cultivating, he should keep on cultivating the spiritual knowledge. One is, you know, the one way of, you know, cultivating spiritual knowledge is also, like, you know, he actually, you know, shares that knowledge with others also. That's the way actually, you know, is knowledge is like, you know, as it is said, right? That what it is that if you don't use, you will lose. The knowledge is also, the spiritual knowledge is, you know, also same in a similar fashion. Unless, you know, you keep on applying it and sharing it with others, actually, you know, it's going to diminish. Now the next three qualities, that is charity, self-control, and performance sacrifice. Prabhupada says this is especially meant for the Grahasthas. For grahastha, this is very, very important. So the grahastha to give charity is very important. And in the next chapter, you'll be seeing that in divisions of the faith, actually Krishna explains what actually the charity is. What are the various ways actually people give charity? In which mode of nature it falls? You know, whether, you know, what this kind of charity which you are making is, you know, it has got permanent impact or no non-permanent impact. All these things actually Krishna will discuss in the next chapter. And the next quality which grahasthas have to cultivate is about self-control. See, the thing is that, you know, until you know you are brahmachari, practically speaking, you'll be requiring how much of space? Now you will be requiring maximum space like that of, you know, 2 feet by 6 feet. That's all. In order to sleep, you just require 2 feet by 6 feet. And if that's there, that's over. You're done with it. And now even if you do not have that pillow, that's okay. You'll use your hand as a pillow and you sleep. So that's the kind of, you know, life now you'll be leading when you're brahmachari. But now when you get into grahastha ashrama, I'll tell you my own example. When I was actually, you know, studying in JNTU, studying in 10th class, I was actually in a hostel. I had only one bag, just one bag. When I got into, when I went to intermediate, I had, you know, two. One is trunk box, full with books, and one more is, you know, one air bag. And when I got into JNTU, I had again two bags only. One big suitcase and one air bag. Over my 4 years of, you know, BTech, just four. Then after that, no, I went to Pune University campus. I stayed in the campus itself. I had again two bags. That's it. Then through campus placement, I got into Bank of Baroda. Then I went to Bangalore in mid-corporate branch. And then again, I had only two bags. Then after that, no, I joined CARE Ratings. And then post that, I got married. And after marriage, after some time, actually, we were shifting the home. When we shifted the home, you don't believe me, we had 50 bags. We had 50 bags. Then after that, no, we actually, no, after some point of the time, you know, we had a child. And again, recently when we shifted the home, we counted the number of bags and it has reached 100. So the thing is that, no, when you get into grahastha ashram, actually, one of the most important things which we need to cultivate is that, you know, self-control. So these things actually keeps on expanding. Then when I was discussing that, you know, ads, you know, this much of luggage, they said that this luggage is nothing. The person who is actually transporting, he was saying that, you know, this luggage is nothing. You people have, you know, very less luggage. We carry the luggage which has got full truck load. At least you are carrying just a small, you know, what do you say, Bolero kind of van. So what will happen is that once we enter into grahastha ashram, there's a lot of self, lot of a scope of, you know, getting into sense gratification, accumulating of the things, and you know it is easy to get into, you know, various kinds of sense gratification attitudes. So we need to cultivate this sense of control when we enter into the grahastha ashram. Prabhupada specifically says that, no, when you enter into grahastha ashram, it's not that, no, you know, wife is there and, no, there's an easy chance of, you know, it's having, you know, something like a license for the free sex. It's not like that. You should be very self-controlled. You need to, you know, Prabhupada actually explains in the, you know, subsequent verses that, you know, when you enter into grahastha ashram, the main purpose of begetting the children will be like, you know, we need to beget the children with the mood of, you know, pleasing Krishna. And when you beget that way, then, you know, the divine children will come. Else, you know, the children which come out just by, you know, having our own sense of fulfillment of our sense gratification, they'll be endowed with the demonic qualities. Means the anger, the pride, the kind of, you know, they show when they're born, they start, you know, developing all these qualities will start coming out when they grow. So that's the reason actually, you know, there's something called, you know, Garbhdharana Samskara, and, you know, various other, you know, principles are there which need to observe very carefully. So their self-control plays a very important role. And performance sacrifice. And earlier, you know, the grahasthas used to perform a sacrifice named called Agnihotra. And in these days, to perform the Agnihotra sacrifice is not easy. So Prabhupada mentioned that, you know, the best and simple sacrifice which you can perform at home is that get up early in the morning and, you know, all the family members sit and do Harinam Sankirtan. Harinam Sankirtan is the best and the most recommended sacrifice in this current age of Kali Yuga. It is mentioned in the Bhagavatam that Kaler Dosho Nide Rajan Asti Yoko Madhvana Kirtana Deva Krishnasya Mukta Sangha Paramrajit. Kaler Dosho Nide Rajan. In this Kali Yuga, there are so many faults at the Kaler Dosho Nide Rajan. Nide Rajan. Nide means an ocean. It's not ordinary ocean. Nide Asti Yoko Madhvana. There's one good quality which is there. What is that good quality? Kirtana Deva Krishnasya. Means, you know, just chant the Hare Krishna mantra, then you know, everything will be taken care of. Mukta Sangha Paramrajit, you will get liberated from this, you know, horrible material existence. That's about, you know, sacrifice. Then the study of the Vedas is especially meant for the, you know, brahmacharis. Brahmacharis will be, when you are actually, you know, in the, before getting married, you'll be having ample amount of time. And that time has to be utilized for study of the scriptures, such as, you know, Bhagavad Gita, Bhagavatam, and all these things under the proper guidance. And it's not that when you become grassroots, you should not do that, but you should do. It is applicable for, you know, all sayers of the Varnas and Ashramas. Then in austerity is especially meant for the people who are into Vanaprastha Ashram. That is, you know, after Grastha, when you know you are, you know, your children are grown up and you married, then you enter into, you know, Vanaprastha Ashram. Especially ideally it should be after 50 years. Of course, now till 50 years also people are in a beginning season. That is a different story. But ideally, if you go by the scientific way of, you know, Vanaprastha, you should be actually able to get into Vanaprastha Ashram post 50 years. At least by 55, 60 years, you should get into Vanaprastha Ashram. And you know, you should observe the austerity. Austerity means, you know, voluntarily taking difficulty for the body and mind. Body will not cooperate at that time, but we need to voluntarily take up the austerity of, you know, waking up early and doing Mangalartis, doing some kind of, you know, nice, you know, pujas with the Lord. Dedicating, you know, spending time in a, you know, study of the scriptures, discussing the scriptures. That is the austerity which one has to perform. Next comes, you know, simplicity, cleanliness. So this simplicity and cleanliness is especially meant for the Brahmanas. Brahmanas have to be very simple at the heart, and they have to maintain cleanliness. And when I say cleanliness, generally we see that, you know, things have to be kept neat. Arrangements, everything should be, no, it's not. There's a difference between cleanliness and neatness. Generally, if you go to the regulated markets, such as, you know, USA, European markets, actually their homes will be very neat. There's a difference between the neatness and cleanliness. Neat means things are nicely arranged and now it's all kept in one place. Cleanliness is something like, you know, which has been uncontaminated. Like, you know, for example, when you go to the washroom, basically you get a little bit contaminated, because you touch some kind of uncontaminated things. So that's the reason, you know, when you pass the urine, it is mentioned that, you know, you need to wash your legs, you need to wash your hands, you need to gargle your mouth. And you should chant the holy names of the Lord in order to purify yourself. That's called cleanliness. And there's two types of cleanliness are there. One is internal cleanliness and one is external cleanliness. External cleanliness is what we see the outside one. Whereas internal cleanliness is basically how you, you know, clean your heart. And the best way of cleaning of the heart is by chanting of the holy names. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Ram, Hare Ram, Ram Ram, Hare Hare. Because, you know, Lord is ultimate pure person. By chanting the names which are, you know, supremely pure, because you are contracting with something supremely pure, even your heart gets purified by that way. And non-violence, it is applicable for everybody. Generally said that this is a common argument which I hear it even at my office. I tell that, why you want to take this? You know, aren't you seeing that, you know, because of this you know, killing of the animals only, the current pandemic situation has arisen? You know, why don't, you know, at least rectify ourselves and why we should trouble the other living entities? Common answer which I get is, I'm not killing any animals. Somebody is killing and I'm taking. My answer is that, no, they are killing because you're eating. They are killing because we are eating. So they are, you know, if everybody stops eating non-veg, then what will happen? Why people will kill? They'll not kill. So that is the reason of what we should take the initiative from our side, that no, we should not get into, you know, this kind of, you know, it is mentioned that, no, every living entity has got its time span by for which, you know, the living entity has to stay on this, in this body, particular body. And once that particular lifespan is over, then the soul has been elevated to the next species of the living entity. Finally, until the soul reaches its journey into the human life. So there are totally somewhere about 8.4 million species of life, and human species are now very less than that. 8.4 million is basically 84 lakhs. Out of that, 4 lakhs is only human form of life. So practically speaking, the soul has to make the traverse of the journey for the 80 lakh species. Then only a living entity will be given an opportunity to get into the 40 lakh species of the human life. So the again, this 40 lakh species comprises of all these characteristics based upon vanas and ashram. Means based upon the qualities a person, the soul has been cultivated through passing through so many stages of the so various living entities. Then comes truthfulness. Truthfulness is basically meant for people who are under the Vaishya category. They should be very truthful. Freedom from anger, renunciation, tranquility, aversion from fault finding, compassion to all living entities, freedom from covetousness, gentleness, modesty, and steady determination. All these are actually qualities which are meant to be cultivated by everybody. Now, when it comes to vigor, forgiveness, and fortitude, these are the qualities which are especially meant for the Kshatriyas. Kshatriya should show the determination, the power, and the means by these characteristics we can know that this person is Kshatriya. A Kshatriya cannot tell that I don't want to be non-violence. Wherever it is required, a Kshatriya has to show non-violence. A police officer cannot say, a police officer is on duty, he cannot say that when something is happening abnormal, I want to be non-violent. He should get into the action, he should take the full responsibility of it and give the necessary punishment. He should be just into action. He cannot even say that according to section number 102, this is, I have to give you punishment. Nothing. By the time the time is over. So you need to show that strong determination, vigor has to come out of him whenever this something nonsense is happening right in front of him. Of course, one more characteristic of a Kshatriya is that if somebody asks forgiveness by rectifying his consciousness, he should forgive that. And one more wonderful quality, which is very dear to me, is fortitude. Fortitude means ability to withstand despite of various difficulties which you are confronting with. That's called fortitude. Then freedom from envy and honor. Although this is categorically may important for the Shudra kind of people, but it's equally important for everybody, because in this age we say that Kalau Shudra Sambhava. It means that most of the people in this age will be having these characteristics, including myself, that we should become free from this envy and honor. If somebody distresses us, if we go to a function, the person who is hosting, if he doesn't address, if he doesn't even see, look at us, will become very, very disappointed. Now we should become free from that kind of honor. We want respect. We want to be respected by others. So this kind of thing is there in our heart. We need to become free from all this. And a person who has become free from all these things is said to be have cultivated divine qualities. And it's a long journey. This Krishna consciousness process is a long journey. It's not like, today you start and tomorrow you become Krishna conscious and develop the divine qualities. It's not going to happen that way. And as the time progresses, I am going to tell you what are the various factors which actually determine that whether we are going towards divine qualities or demonic qualities. All these things we'll be discussing. Now the descriptions for the demonic qualities is mentioned here. So in the demonic consciousness, what will happen is that a person do not know actually what is to be done, what is not to be done. They're not practically speaking. So in the scriptures, actually, there are now many examples are there, but now we can correlate the similar kind of demonic characteristics even in the present world also. Like when we see the Hitler, examples like that of Hitler and all. We can clearly identify that this is something which is not to be done, but he has done it in the concentration camp, killing so many hundreds of people, thousands of people, whether it's to be done no, it has not to be done. So you know, these are the people who are endowed with the demonic qualities, and they don't believe in God. What is God? Nothing. No God, nothing. Everything is born out of the sex desire. How the world is formed? World is, you know, basically, you know, it's basically, you know, man and, you know, female, male and female, you know, they'll, you know, join, they get together and they have sex, and then the progeny has been created. That's why the entire world is created. In any species, if you see, that's what they say. How is actually the animal species, or, you know, the bird species, or, you know, the insect species, everybody, you know, has having the sex, and that's why actually the entire world is running. You know, where's the question of the God? There's no question of the God. God is not there. For such kind of people, only one answer we have to give, that why there's so many infertility centers are there. If you see in Hyderabad or in any other metropolitan city, so many infertility centers are there. Why is that, you know, despite of, you know, having all these things, why this is there? Because, you know, it's not that, you know, just by, you know, having, you know, just by meeting, you know, the embryo will develop. There's so many factors which are involved. So these demonic people say that everything is born of the sex desire. And they get engaged in so many unbeneficial and horrible works which are meant to destroy the world. I'll just take an example in this category. Of course, in the Netflix also, you know, they started now making this kind of series about this person. They are making series of some 6 billionaires who actually, you know, what do you say, got into, you know, difficulties and all these things. So this particular person was actually born in a very, you know, aristocratic family, unfortunately. But no, what has happened is he got into business, and, you know, liquor business and all these things. When he got into liquor business, he made, you know, a lot of money. Then, you know, he actually has to flaunt the money. He got into, you know, a lot of horrible activities. Then, you know, one day what happened is that, you know, he wanted to, you know, fly from, you know, one place to another place, and he went to airport, but no, he was drunk. He has partied and he was drunk. And when he was drunk, what happened is that the Air India people, they said that, no, we will not allow you to get inside the plane because, you know, we have seen that, you know, you're drunk. And now if you're drunk and if you misbehave inside, then it is going to cause a lot of damage to our damage and reputation to our organization. So we'll not allow you. And the person who was a business baron, he became so very angry that, no, right then and there, he decided that, no, I'm going to start my own flight. And within 6 months, he got all the approvals and he started his own flight. However, consequently, because of, you know, this is all, you know, this pride and ego, he got into this particular business. Till that time, you know, though it was a liquor business, it was doing well, but a lot of money was being invested in this particular line of activity. And subsequently, you know, he got into huge losses, severe losses he got into it because of that, you know, fall of that particular air division, the business which is coming from air division. And no, he wanted to actually earn money through a lot of illegal means. Of course, liquor itself is illegal means of earning the money. And it is born out of so much of lust and anger. And subsequently, actually, you know, he was consumed by this kind of, you know, misactivities. And no, finally, you know, it's you know, the entire reputation which has been garnered, which is totally demolished within, you know, in no time. So that's the, you know, description about the demonic qualities, and there are some more, you know, characteristics of the demonic qualities are there. So these are some of the characteristics of demonic qualities. They are very self-complacent, they're impudent, and they have a lot of, they're deluded by the wealth and, you know, false prestige. And, you know, when it comes to sacrifice, they tell that, you know, they, if they're giving, you know, money, just take it. You are, you know, at my mercy, you take it. So this is, you know, very dangerous. Even if they perform, you know, if they give, you know, charity, they tell that, no, my name should be written there. It's because of me it is running. No, this is like, you know, very, very demonic qualities. But sometimes it happens, like, you know, once it was happening, even in our temple situation also, some political politicians were coming and telling that, no, we will give the so and so amount of the charity, but no, this has to run according to our, you know, wins and losses. And now the management said that it's not going to happen that way. There are certain principles actually which are you know, our founder has laid down, and this temple is going to run that fashion only. So we do not want your money. So you know, we need request such kind of, you know, bold steps. We need to take it whenever, you know, we encounter with such kind of people. Charity has to be done, and any sacrifice has to be done, you know, with the mood of, you know, pleasing Krishna and without any expectation. Here there is no, it's a mood of pleasing Krishna, not the mood of pleasing me. You should please me, and a lot of expectations are there that no, it should run according to my own terms and conditions. This comes out to, you know, demonic quality, and they don't follow any rules and regulations. So in this context, actually, you know, Prabhupada also explains a beautiful example of you know, Hiranyakashipu and Ravana also. They don't follow any rules and regulations. Rather, you know, Ravana was, you know, such a kind of cruel person that, you know, he actually, you know, went to various places, and he was actually conquering this and, you know, defeating this person, that person. Finally, you know, Nadamun tells him that, you know, only one place. Finally, gets an idea that, you know, only one place I didn't conquer till now is hell. Even hell has to be governed by, you know, what the way I want. So I'll go and fight with the Yamraj. So he goes and he fights with Yamraj.
Prabhuji,
yeah.
I'm sorry to interrupt. Some feedbacks have come. If voice can be made a little more louder, if possible, if some arrangement possible, you can see.
Yeah.
Microphone can be taken near or something. Rest is fine. It's clear, but some volume is little low. That's the main thing. Thank you.
I'm sorry. Yeah, I'll try to speak louder. Is it better now?
Yes, Prabhuji. We can proceed. We'll see.
Okay, yeah. Thank you. So Ramana was actually, you know, such a kind of, you know, if so much impudence and, you know, so much of, you know, false prestige there within himself, that actually he went to, you know, hell where actually Yamraj was punishing. He picked up the fight with Yamraj. And Yamraj practically becomes so very angry within that point. Actually, with the power of Yamraja, he could have actually, you know, destroyed Ravana. Yamraj has a power. Yamraj is a pure devotee, and no, he has got all powers. He has got up. Krishna has endowed him with so much power. He could have done that, but Nadamuni comes and says, don't do that. Don't kill him. His death is in the hands of Vishnu. So please wait. So Yamraj, you know, immediately abstains himself, and, you know, immediately disappears from that place. And, you know, this Ravana foolishly thinks that, yeah, he's gone. He's not there on the battlefield, and he ran away means he actually has accepted his defeat. He thinks this way. He doesn't think that, no, Yamraj is actually out of humility. In order to obey what Narada Muni has said, he has taken this step. But no, he thinks that, no, he is gone now. Now the hell is also in my hands. So these are the characteristics of the demonic natures. And they're bewildered by so much of ego and pride, and they blaspheme the religion. There's so much actually blaspheme the religion. Actually, to say honestly, you know, in India, we say that India is actually, you know, so much of, you know, predominance of, you know, Hindus is there. But honestly speaking, you know, majority of the Hindus, they don't observe Hinduism. They do something which is ritualistic. Something which is ritualistic, that's all. They don't even ask that, you know, why this has to be done, for what purpose it has to be done. I'm telling honestly, there are some festivals which are, you know, regularly, which all the people celebrate. What are the festivals? Dasara is celebrated, Diwali is celebrated, Sankranti is celebrated. These are, you know, regular festivals which are celebrated. What does Dasara means for us? Dasara means that, you know, go to a shop, purchase new clothes, wear the clothes, and there's something called Jambi Puja. They do the puja for the Jambi. They exchange the leaves or, you know, something like this. And, you know, that's all. And when it comes to Diwali, Diwali is the best time for the gratifying our senses. Nice sweets will be prepared that day. And after, in the evening times, after, you know, some Lakshmi Puja. In Lakshmi Puja is also filled with all material desires. Sukha Sampati Pave. We ask Krishna that, give me this Sukha Sampati. So after, you know, that puja and all, what is the distribution of sweets will happen? We'll eat the sweets. And what will happen immediately after that? Go and play the crackers. Why crackers are still busted, we do not know. Why the day has to be celebrated, we do not know. Sankranti, the day, the Sankranti means go and play the kites, fly the kites and enjoy. Ganesh Puja means, it's a, honestly speaking, you know, a lot of mockery will be made in the name of Ganesh. Actually, I used to stay in habits for a pretty long time, and we used to see that, no, there are no varieties of, you know, Ganesh. Ganesh in the form of Hrithik Roshan, Ganesh in the form of, you know, Vatal, we do not know. All kinds of, you know, forms of Ganesh were there. Ganesh as a bodybuilder, it was there. So, you know, Ganesh is taking selfie. So what we make really mockery out of it. Entire Ganesh Puja is actually, you know, so much of mockery has been made, and all they do is that they booze and they play. They actually, you know, dance in front of that big lorry. So these are all like, you know, this is not religion. This is actually against the religious principles. Strictly against religious principles. This is actually blaspheming the Lord. We should never do this way, actually. So this is, by doing this way, they tell them, this is what actually Ganesh Puja. If you go and speak to them. So this all comes under, this appears to be like, you know, divine, but it's not divine actually. You're doing something, that's all. It's not actually divine. So now, you know, before we could say that, what does Krishna do for such kind of, you know, demonic people? Before this, actually, you know, one more verse is there, which I thought of, you know, just reading it out. About the wealth, actually, Krishna tells so very wonderfully. The demonic person thinks, so much wealth do I have today, and I will gain more according to my schemes. So much is mine now, and it will increase in the future more and more. He is my enemy, and I have killed him. And my other enemies will also be killed. I am the lord of everything. I am the enjoyer. I am perfect, powerful, and happy. I'm the richest man, surrounded by aristocratic relatives. There's none so powerful and happy as I am. I shall perform sacrifices. I shall give some charity, and thus I shall rejoice. In this way, such persons are deluded by ignorance. Thus, perplexed by various anxieties and bound by a network of illusions, they become too strongly attached to sense enjoyment and fall down into hell. Actually, no, it is, you know, some traits of this demonic qualities, actually, you know, we can relate to our own hearts. The thing is that, no, when we actually get into the professional life, you know, we actually start comparing with our peers. That time, he has got so and so. That time, we start working hard. Then when we get promotion, we are not satisfied there. We want to work harder. We want to get next position. This keeps on, this lust which is there. By the way, the definition of the lust which is there in the dictionary is totally different from the lust which I'm referring here. The lust means basically unsatiated desire to fulfill our sense enjoyment tendencies. That is called lust. Unsatiated desire to fulfill our, you know, sense gratificatory tendencies. That's called lust. So this particular lust which is there, that one next position, we want to earn money. Even if, you know, sufficient amount of bank balance is there, then the next what you think is that, let me purchase a house, let me get into this business, let me invest in the stock market. Then your anxiety keeps building up. Inside, the anxiety keeps building up. Then we are never satisfied. When we get up, we start thinking that, what happened to this particular investments which I made, how much it has grown, what is the net present value, NPV, net present value of this particular stock, this particular mutual funds. The anxiety keeps building up. 9:40 market starts, your anxiety builds up. Invested money in some kind of, you know, business, anxiety builds up. You go beyond, you know, whatever it has been mentioned, anxiety builds up significantly. So we need to be very careful in when we are doing anything. So what does, you know, Krishna will do for the people who are endowed with the demonic qualities? He perpetually casts them into ocean of material existence in different species of life. Now somebody may say that, no, Krishna is, you know, pretty harsh. Krishna is supposed to be all merciful. Why is doing so? No. See, if it is something like this, which we can see practically in our lives also, somebody is creating a lot of disturbance in the society. What actually the government has to do? Arrest him and keep him in the jail. That's it. Lot of disturbance in the society will be curbed. So similarly, what Lord does is that, no, this person is doing so much of, you know, disturbance to the society, human society. what he has to do? He has to create a system of the material and nature in such a way that the person has to be castrated in such kind of, you know, species where, you know, those kind of tendency will be exhibited in that. Something like, you know, assume that, you know, the species like that of a snake, venomous snakes, the tigers, the what do you say, the ferocious animals, they're all products. They mention they are actually, you know, based upon the tendencies the body is awarded. I know Krishna mercifully does it. It is his mercy upon them. And we have also seen that, you know, sometimes out of great mercy, Lord actually gives them the liberation by way of, you know, killing them. For example, Putana is there. He has been killed. Putana has been killed by Lord. Ravana is killed by the Lord. Hiranyakashipu killed by Lord. By killing them, actually got liberation. Or, you know, sometimes what will happen is that devotees themselves go and give their association. Ratnakar was there. In the Ramayana, we can see that Ratnakar actually was, you know, killing and looting and doing so many things. But by the interaction of Narada Muni, what will happen? Actually, all his demonic qualities will go away. So that's a special mercy of the Lord. Either he sends the devotees, or, you know, he himself comes and does something to them. Or the material nature actually takes care of it. And they again and again take the repeated birth in the demonic life. And for them, it is very difficult to approach the Lord. And the Lord speaks this out of very great compassion, that, you know, how actually these people get themselves into such kind of stage. They feel it, you know, pretty bad. Lord actually speaks this out of pain. It's not like, you know, Lord is rejoicing there. Now the last conclusion point, pre-conclusion, like, you know, we can say. So there are three gates of the hell. The first one is the lust, the second one is anger, then the third one is greed. The lust, as I was saying, that not the unsatiated desire to fulfill the sense gratification tendencies. And when that is not fulfilled, you get an anger. And by somehow you try to achieve it, the greed develops. There will not stop. You want more and more and more. The more greed comes, the more lust comes, the more lust comes, the more anger comes. And it's like a big cycle, it is. Cycle. And all these things actually, you know, it's like in a cocoon. You get actually, you know, got stung into the cocoon and you get, you know, totally, you know, get, you know, absorbed in that, you know, cocoon, so that, you know, you'll not be able to come out. It's a difficulty which is created by yourself, not by anybody else. So these are three gates to hell. And now I just get into the conclusion part. Now what will happen to the person who gets entangled in the three gates to hell? The people who get entangled in the three gates of the hell is that they get absorbed in the something which is totally non-permanent. And they will neither be happy now, or they will neither be happy after that also. You just see the people who are not demonic in nature. Like, you know, for example, why so much, you know, demand in nature? I'll tell a small example. Like, you know, a traffic signal is a red signal is there, and you're seeing that, you know, the police people, the traffic police people are there. And, you know, out of, you know, some of this demand nature comes in our mind, and we think that, you know, we will just escape from this red light. When we escape from the red light and, you know, start driving fast, what will happen? Anxiety builds up. What is the anxiety? That, you know, the person may catch me. And in order to, you know, what do you say, become free from the police, you try to run much faster. So these people are actually, you see, this is the same point which I am telling. That is, the point is that you are neither happy when you are doing it, and, you know, after doing that activity also, you are not happy. Rather, you know, your anxiety is building up. So these people will be neither happy after that or before that. And they actually deride. One of the most important characteristic of the demonic people, which differentiates from the divine people, is that they don't observe the scriptural injunctions. They don't observe scriptural injunctions. This is one thing which actually demarcates between the divine and demonic. Whether the person is following the scriptural injunctions is a divine. Not following scriptural injunctions, demonic. Finished. Only one verse, Prabhupada makes it now clear that, no, what is that actually which differentiates? Krishna makes it clear. People who follow these scriptural injunctions, they are divine. Those who don't follow, the divine. They are demonic. And what will happen to people now who actually endeavor to escape from these three gates of the hell? So they actually know they get the results which are permanent, and they are on the path of this self-realization. From the childhood, actually we are being trained in such a way that we are actually learned or habituated to learn the outside things, but we have never took the time to actually learn what is actually happening within our hearts. Krishna consciousness is a journey which is inside. It is journey within. Journey within it is. It is not journey outside. When we actually go inside, we'll understand that there's a lot of repair work which has to be done inside our hearts. So it is a science of self-realization, a science of journey within. So that's about the divine. And one must understand that what is the duty and what is not the duty by regulations of scriptures. And by doing so, actually one will gradually get elevated. So that's a very important point actually. See, I was just taking the example of Yamaraj, right? What is different between Yamaraj and Ravana? Yamaraj was actually listening to the words of Narad Muni, whereas Ravana, he was not at all hearing. He's not at all hearing. So consequently, the demonic nature has come out. I'm telling one thing that whatever the tendencies you have, but one thing what you have to take care is that we should cultivate this habit of approaching a one person who is endowed with divine quality and submit to him and learn from him actually how we need to lead with the scriptural injunctions, because scriptural injunctions are so wide and varied. What to apply, what not to apply, we do not know. So that's the reason we need to approach a person and we should learn from him. And this is a process, a very personal process. It takes long haul, and we need to actually be sincere and very patient. Then it's going to work out. So with this, I would like to conclude. Thank you very much. I would like to take if there are any questions.
Yes. Before we proceed for questions, I'll just show you one because I'll just share here the screen. 1 minute. And audience are encouraged to ask the questions. Anybody wants to even write in chat box or ask personally, we'll unmute them. Here on the screen you are seeing, it's called as the Gita Subodhini. After all of you have successfully completed the, completing almost now more 2 days to go for 18 chapters. So what is after that? So our temple is hosting these next sessions called as Gita Subodhini. Now, because time was less every day, we are condensing the chapter to complete in 1 hour. But to understand most important shlokas, total overall Bhagavad Gita, 108 shlokas are very important. So that we have been planned. And every Wednesday and Sunday, these 2 days will be scheduled for over the duration of 4 months. So these are total 108 shlokas we are going to study every Wednesday and Sunday after the 18 days our this course gets over. And for that, we'll be sharing you the WhatsApp link in your chat box. You can join that WhatsApp group for this course so that you'll get the notification for that also. And especially for those who are youths here in this forum, especially 30 years or less than that. So for them, we have a special youth forum also. They will be contacting you. Many of them, they might have got contacted. So we encourage for them not to fill this forum. For them, there'll be separate courses will be running. But for others, it's open for all for joining this course. So thank you. So we'll take the question answers. I'll just, anybody wants to ask, they can raise their hands. We'll unmute them and, or they can unmute themselves also. Yeah, here it is.
There's a question which is there here. What is Aham Brahmasmi? What is it? What is Aham Brahmasmi? Aham Brahmasmi means basically, and the spirit soul. And the spirit soul. And the eternal spirit soul, part and parcel of the Lord. That's what actually Aham Brahmasmi means. And this is particular aphorism which is there in all the Vedic literatures. That we need to understand that we are not this body, but we are the spirit soul. we are not this body, but we are the spirit soul. Because this body is something which is characterized of five gross and three subtle elements. What are the five gross elements? Is that earth, water, fire, air, and ether. That's called, that they are the five gross items: earth, water, fire, air, and ether. And three subtle elements are like, you know, mind, intelligence, false ego. So these are the mind, intelligence, false ego. These are also actually the subtle elements which are coverings over the soul. But no, soul is a, which is there, which is permanent. It is permanent one. So we need to understand that now we are actual spirit soul, part and parcel of the Lord. We are supposed to be engaged in service of the Lord, but somehow we are caught up here in this material world. So that was the Aham Brahmasmi means. To realize that now we are the spirit soul being covered by it.
Thank you. Anyone want to ask personally, they can raise their hands. We'll unmute them and can reply. Here one question have come, Prabhuji, in the chat. Hare Krishna, is from Shiva. Hare Krishna, we heard in a few discussion on Gita mentioning that investing in stock market is also bad. And I think Prabhuji is the best teacher for us to guide because Prabhuji has studied about the management and all. And not only that, but Krishna consciousness practices. What is the best way of investing? Or is this a passive investment is bad, what we are doing in the stock market? So please, Prabhuji.
Yeah. I have done MBA finance. Not only just MBA, I have done MBA and finance itself. The entire finance is actually speaks about the stock market, honestly speaking. So after studying entire MBA finance, honestly speaking, I don't have even one demat account. I think most of you may be knowing what is demat account. Demataccount is basically dematerialized account which is utilized for doing the stock marketing. I don't have any demat account. See, the definition of the gambling, actually, if you want to observe Krishna consciousness, you have to follow the four regulative principles. So what are the four related principles? Four related principles are no meat eating, no gambling, no intoxication, and no illicit sex. So why it will come under gambling category? The definition of the gambling is that anything which is where the output is not certain is called gambling. Where the outcome is not certain, it falls under gambling category. And stock market is one such kind of, investment of the money, where actually we do not know what is outcome. And honestly speaking, what is happening in this stock market, most of us do not know. Honestly speaking, most of us do not know. I am there in this corporate industry for last 10 years, and I'm dealing with, several companies which are actually listed. And now you see, just we completed September month. Even before the quarter results are out, we all know that the quarter results of any company will be actually published on the BSE or NSE. And before the quarterly results are out, the correction of the stock market is already done. How the correction of the stock market is getting done? Because the matter is already out in the market there, that how the results are going to be. You are not aware, you are a common man. You and I, we are common man. We do not know what is happening inside. But the stock correction is already taking place. It means what? Some people actually are running this entire show. And they know how to actually pull it up and they know how to actually pull it down. Of course, there can be some stocks, some companies which are doing well and based upon that it is going up. But the whole funda, what I'm telling is that here is something which actually the outcome of it we do not know. So many investment bankers are there. And they're doing so much of valuation, DCF valuation. They call it DCF valuation is there. Discounted cash flow, which is a famous model which has been used. These are all based upon all speculations and assumptions. Last year, my friend is there, who was actually working as an investment banker at KPMG. And he's actually made lot of valuation upon companies that in order to make some acquisitions and mergers and all these things. And he was telling that, what will happen to all this, assumptions which I made and thinking that this stock value is going to improve and all these things that we never assumed that this kind of pandemic will arise. But all the valuations which has made, everything is gone to toss. Everything is gone to toss. And he's telling that no, we cannot actually rely upon any of the valuations, the valuation reports which were prepared earlier, and shared it with our investors. So it is very important to understand that these things are actually very, very uncertain. We should not invest in the stock market. That's the reason it's called gambling, because outcome is uncertain.
Thank you, Guruji. Krishna consciousness is the only true investment where we can really
correct. correct. Krishna is the only investment. Because as I'm telling, here the investment is in terms of the relationship in the Krishna. We actually invest in money. Money will not give anything, I'm telling you. Invest in the relationships with the devotees. Invest in relationship with Krishna. That will give you the strength to withstand in any kinds of difficulties which you go through. These investments, what is this? And this is all, temporary, amelioration to the mind. That's all that for my, I invested 1 lakh, it became 1.5 lakhs. How does it matter to you? But tomorrow it falls down, similar anxiety will come. But investment in relationship always gives you the strength and the courage to move forward. One of the devotees has been infected with a very, very, very unfortunately, he was being infected with disease. And he was very happy. Why? Because he is surrounded by the loving people in and around him. He is saying that it doesn't matter to me. I'll tell you one more example. In the month of February, unfortunately, one Mataji caught into some fire accident at home itself. And 70% of the body was burnt. She was admitted to hospital. I'll tell you one thing. She was in the hospital for 15 days and not one day there was one drop of tear was there from rice. That why it has happened to me? I was chanting, I was chanting 16 rounds. I was following Krishna. No. She never complained to Krishna that why this has happened to me. Rather, she was very happy that so many well-wishers are there to me. They're coming and they are wishing well for me. They're giving me all kinds of encouragement. Not even one drop of tear was there from her eyes. And the day on which she has to pass away, she left her body. That day morning, so many devotees were somehow praying for her. And that is the time actually, some of the loving devotees were, just beside her, who have actually invested so much of love and care upon her. And that is the time actually she left her body. What an opulence. What an opulence of leaving the body. Please invest upon the relationships. Invest on genuine relationships. That is the real investment. Invest on relationship with Krishna. That actually gives all the strength. The stock market is of no use actually. I'm telling you, being in MBA finance, working in the corporate industry for a pretty long time, I'm telling that I don't have demat account. What is proof is required for you?
Thank you, Guruji. Many participants are appreciating today's presentation. They learned many good qualities from this. And knowing about for this investment, some of the parents are asking, I think, how can we give this jnana right from school so that we don't see such atrocities in the world? What can we? Because you are especially into the children's education as your introduction, I guess. So they're asking.
Actually, honestly speaking, a lot starts from at home only. To say honestly, a lot depends upon how actually we are conducting at our home. They say charity begins at home. So we need to start the work on ourselves and automatically it comes out. And one more way is that, in our temple also actually we conduct this classes for the children, exclusively meant for their own built up of the character. So here actually, we are speaking a lot of philosophy on divine and demonic qualities, but actually there we don't speak philosophy. There we speak majorly a storyline will be discussed. And based upon the storyline, the children are taught how actually to behave, what is right behavior and what is wrong behavior. What is the right thought process and what is the wrong thought process. And a lot of things have been taught actually. So if children are there, if first thing is that you should be interested in becoming a devotee. And if you can give an opportunity to children also to enroll in such kind of programs, is very beneficial. Very beneficial. Many times, in the children education, what I've seen is that they admit the children, my children, let him be a very nice person, but I'll remain where I am. Then what will happen is that they started sending the children, and children started become very good devotees. So when they used to go to home, what used to happen is that they used to tell the parents, "Papa, we are not supposed to do this one, no. Papa, we are not supposed to lie, no." Then when they started, you know, saying like this, then the parents got really, you know, annoyed that, "No, you are teaching me." And they stopped actually children, you know, sending to temple actually. So the problem, the main problem what we are seeing is that the parents have to first of all, you know, start taking these courses and start developing relationship with the devotees and take guidance from them and act according to the guidance. Then, you know, gradually, you know, when the children also see that, you know, these kind of, you know, wonderful examples in the parents, automatically, you know, they also will follow this process. So that's the best way. And second way is that, as I was telling that, no, at the time of, assume that, no, you already, you know, have children and all this phase is done, then this is what we have to do. Assume that you don't have children, you are in the process of, you know, begetting children. Then for that sake, you need to actually, you know, observe the process called Gardhan Samskara. And in the process of Gardhan Samskara, before doing Gardhan Samskara, there's a lot of big processes there. You know, the way to beget the children, divine children. There's a process which is there. First of all, both mother and father have to undertake some kind of austerity. I'll tell you one thing, you know, Vasudeva and Devaki have undergone austerity for, you know, some thousands of years meditating. And post that, actually, Lord has given them the benediction that, no, I will appear in your womb, Devaki, in your womb, for three times. For three times I'll appear. So that's what actually, Lord appears in people, divine people are actually born when you perform such kind of austerities. So austerity has to be performed, and a lot of, you know, services are to be rendered selflessly. See, children are born out of our own heart. Children are basically a reflection of our own heart. The way our heart is there, the same way the children will come out. So assume that now already children, your children, the best is that, no, you become the devotee and you train the children to become devotee. That's the best way.
Thank you. Thank you, Guruji.
There's one question for me. Yeah, I think it's privately sent. Yeah, it's privately sent.
Yes.
What is simplicity is one question which is there. Simplicity is basically, you should be able to tell the truth to a person without considering whether this person is enemy or friend. That's what the simplicity is actually quality of a brahmana. I'll tell one example of the simplicity. The example is that there was one small boy was there, and he has approached the muni, telling that, "Now, my dear Lord, actually I want to learn the Vedic Vedas, and now please tell me that, no, what should I do? That, no, how should I learn? That, no, I want to become your disciple." Like that he approaches, and the sage will tell that, "I would like to know who your father is." Then, you know, this boy doesn't know who his father is, so he goes and asks his mother, "My dear mother, no, I want to learn so and so, but no, this person, this sage is telling that he wants to know my father. So who my father is?" So mother will tell that, "No, beta, I know, I have been with so many men. I do not know out of which man actually you are born. So I'm sorry, I do not know who your father is." Then, you know, the boy is, you know, he goes and he tells to report to the son, the sage, saying that, "No, this is what is my situation." And the sage will tell that, "No, I'm so very happy to hear that, no, you are so very simple-minded that, no, you're able to disclose your mind, even though it is so very embarrassing for anybody to tell that, no, anybody to disclose this kind of, you know, situation, you're able to disclose it with all simplicity of the heart. I'm so very pleased with it." So actually the sage will give all Vedic knowledge to this person, to that boy. So that is called simplicity. Simplicity means, you know, not considering any kinds of, you know, AS about oneself to disclose the mind, especially to the superiors. Superiors means, again, I'm not telling the superiors. Superiors, when I'm telling that, no, these are the superiors who are actually observing the Vedic principles and religious life nicely. They are called our superiors. That's about revelation. That is called simplicity of the mind. And you don't calculate. You don't calculate your mind so much. Why this, why that? No complexity. That's called simplicity. And also, there is also one more question here. Prabhuji, on the lighter note, someone who is controlling the market is Krishna. the ones who do not know, are we the common men? Yeah, I just answer this and I'll explain about this. 42 is the next question. Who is controlling the market is Krishna. Who is controlling the market is you can say that no, by that means that everything is controlled by Krishna only. But now Krishna gives the free will for the individuals to act. So people who misutilize the free will are operating this market, the stock market. People who have their own vested interests on what to do with a particular stock, they are actually controlling the market, the stock market. So they are not Krishna. They are not Krishna. And the one who is not known, are we the common men? Yeah, we are the common men. We do not know what actually is happening behind the screens. So when we do not know, basically we should not get into it. When we do not know anything about full picture, we should not get into it. Only when we know full picture about anything, we should take up. Please explain the fortitude. Now, even during the discussion, I was explaining the fortitude. Fortitude means ability to withstand the difficulties, the strength to withstand the difficulties, and remain on the path of religious principles is called fortitude. It's a very wonderful quality, and it is meant for everybody. Though it is said that for the Kshatriyas it is very important, but for everybody it's important.
Yeah, here one question have come through. What is the meaning of regulation of scriptures? They noticed in the slide presentations.
Regulation of the scriptures means observing the scripture. Very nice question actually. See, the scriptures are also actually wide and varied. Which principle to apply and all, we do not know. There can be no principle which can be applicable. There are certain things which has to be applicable at different stages in different manner. Though the scriptures are universal and applicable to everybody, but the way it has to be induced is different. For example, a person is suffering from dangerous disease like that of the TB and all. The way the medication done that is done is very different actually. First of all, high dosage is given. They see that how the body is reacting. Then they see that the next level of the dosage, next level of the dosage. And when the things are actually stabilizing, they start bringing down the dosage. So in the scriptures also, there are high levels of the applicator principles are there. And we need to see what is actually applicable to us. For that, we require proper guidance. Proper guidance is required. So regulation by the scriptures means we need to regulate our life as per the direction which we are receiving from the scriptures through a devotee. Through a devotee. See, we do not know whether we are operating mode of ignorance, mode of passion, or mode of goodness. If you are operating mode of ignorance, the kind of instructions which are given to you in order to elevate you from the ignorance to passion and passion to goodness is totally different than from a person who is already operating in goodness and from there it to be elevated to the pure goodness level. So the regulation by scripture means accepting the guidance, if you ask me, is accepting the guidance of the scriptures coming through from a devotee. That's called regulation by scriptures. And this is a very personal process I'm telling, although we all are attending in a very virtual way, that we actually have to take this in a personal way. We have to actually accept this guidance, then only the things will actually become practical in our life. Yes, Prabhu.
Here one hands are raised, I'll unmute them. Chintamani Sahani. Yes, you can unmute yourself and ask question.
Hare Krishna, Prabhuji. Prabhuji, it's such a complex question. See, the corona is almost getting over. We had started going out, and it was nice, 6 months staying in the house, going through a lot of classes, and the Krishna consciousness. It was so good. But now, since I started going out, I see from that point of view that entire existence is in question, and I see a huge task. How do I exist in this world? I mean, if I have to do something to bring them into this consciousness, and how do I tolerate all those things? I'm worried. And even if I'm not, if I don't have to worry, how I will tolerate myself? How I will be living? looking at things around and just how can I tolerate all this?
That's a good question. That's a pragmatic question. I think this question will be there in the hearts of everybody. So you just brought it out. See, my dear friend, I'll tell you one thing, that no, we need to understand what is the goal of our life. When we know what is the goal of our life, we'll know how to deal with all the situations. I'll tell you an example. Recently, you know, I had to take one devotee to one hospital. I took to the hospital to get an appointment itself. It was such a tough thing. She was the lady assistant was not giving me the appointment. It was such a horrible experience going through itself. So I took an appointment and I took the devotee. When I took the devotee, and the devotee was, you know, patiently was trying to explain. And he was, when I was trying to explain, the doctor had one word that is, I also used Ayurveda. This allopathic doctors, they become very irritated when they hear the word for Ayurveda. He becomes so very irritated. He's about 70 years old doctor. And he was getting so irritated and so angry. But no, I was also getting angry because how he cannot become, like that. But I was maintaining myself the patience, the tolerance. I was just tolerating. Because my goal is not to become angry upon him and screw him up. My goal is that get a medication from him and get out of it so that my friend devotee's health will become proper. That is my goal. If I become angry upon him, then I'll be losing the medicinal knowledge which has garnered, which can be used to treat this person so that my friend devotee can become nice person. Get back to his normal health. No, what is the goal is what we have to see in our life. The goal of our life is to revive our relationship with the Lord. And we need to see that how everything is fitting into that. And I'm telling that in this world there's nothing called imperfect. Everything is in its place. Everything is in its place. We should understand this. There's one particular verse which is there in Ishopanishad. Om Purnamada Purnamidam Purnapurnam Udachyate. All arrangements are made for every living entity to realize the Supreme Lord. All the arrangements are made. It means what? It means if I'm going through any difficulty, that difficulty is actually necessary for me in order to realize the Supreme Lord. There's no difficulty which is being created, which we don't deserve. Everything in our life is being, properly orchestrated as per our past karma and also in order to realize the Supreme Lord. Yes, every day, even I drive 30-35 minutes going towards the office and coming back from the office. I face a lot of traffic. But nowadays, I got used to it. And what is the best thing what I'm doing nowadays is that I'm calling some of my friend devotees and discussing with them about Krishna Katha. Last 3 months back, I was staying very near to my office. Office was only 7 minutes journey. But now I have moved to a place where actually I have to make a journey of 30-35 minutes. But it is good actually. I was not able to maintain relationship with the devotees. Now I am able to speak, spend time with them, make positive contribution to myself, and make positive contribution to others. And spending time, hearing some nice kirtans, and spending time in contemplating about the teachings of Bhagavad Gita and Bhagavatam, which was not there earlier. So I'm utilizing that time. I know that this is, the traffic is not going to change, whether I regret or don't regret. It is going to be there. Traffic is going to be there. The problems are going to be there. So we need to observe, we need to get into the, what is the goal of my life? My goal of my life is to develop my relationship with the Lord, revive my relationship with the Lord. What is the best way? Best way is that keep on remembering what are the instructions which is given by the Lord. Practice those instructions. That's the best way actually. So we need to get into this details, this thing. And second thing is that the pandemic situation which has arisen, it is the consequence of, the human beings only doing the blunders. You see, in the Chinese country, people actually, they eat anything and everything which is there on the, which is moving. Quite dangerous. As you have got right to live on this planet, every living entity has got right to live on this planet. You are nobody to actually harass any living entity on the planet. But now these people, they have seen, you know, some of the videos of that, you know, wet market. It is so very horrible. They even, you know, culture the snakes, culture the, what do you say, cockroaches and this and that. No, some of them, many of them are innocent in, what do you say, living entities. You cannot do that. And they, you have done to so and so thing to the nature, and Mother Nature is actually reacting to all this. Mother Nature is heavily reacting. So we need to observe the religious principles thoroughly, and we need to be focused. We need to be focused upon, you know, what actually we want out of our life, because life is very short and we have passed half of it. Most of you may be like, you know, 25 to 30 years old, and some of you must have crossed 40. You should assume that, you know, 60 to 65% of your life is done, and your life is also quite uncertain. What is going to happen? Today we are there means today we are there, that's all. So today when we are there, see that, you know, how can I actually take up every situation which is coming across my life to develop my relationship with the Lord. So that's a way, that's what I would like to say.
Yeah, thank you, Guruji. Here one more hand has raised. Uma Mageshwari. Yes, you can unmute and ask. Yes, you are muted. You can unmute and ask.
Good morning, sir. So I have one thing about relationship. See, in this world, we come across a lot of people. Most of them is passing. But when we go into a committed relation, you know, into a family, there are a lot of relations, new relations which come up. We don't get along with everyone. We are having some attraction towards some people. And we try to move away from some others. This is possible in any other situation, but when it comes to a family, sometimes frequency might not be good, but yet we are forced to stay with them. So in such relations, how to balance? Like when we try to move or keep away or maintain distance, we'll be condemned because it is forced upon us. This is practical for everyone. So you cannot just keep walking away from certain people or relations. So how to balance and handle keep moving towards our goal?
That's a nice question. I'll just take one example. See, there was one great ruler named Parikshit Maharaj. Very, very unceremoniously, he was been cursed by one particular Brahmana. And the curse was that, from today, on the seventh day, a flying snake bird will come and it will bite you, and that will be the cause of your death. That is what actually the curse is. And when he gets the curse, immediately he'll give up entire kingdom. Right that moment, he'll give up the entire kingdom. And he'll go and sit near the, you know, banks of the Ganges. And now he'll be praying. At that time, actually, you know, he'll make one prayer. What is the prayer? Is that Punasya Bhuyat Bhagavat Yanante Rati Prasangat Pradashreyeshu Masu Yamyam Upayami Sishyam Maitrasu Sarvat Namod Vijayam. My dear Lord, if at all I have got one more birth, I would like to have, you know, these three desires to be fulfilled. First one is that friendly relationship with all the living entities. Friendly relationship with all the living entities. The second one is a deep attraction towards your devotees. I would like to take their association. Third one is that I want, you know, unalloyed devotion towards you. So these are three desires which he prays actually. So in these three, if you see, one of the first one is that, you know, friendly relationship with everybody. That is very important. As you're telling, we get along with somebody, we don't get along with somebody. You know, some of the close relationship, we have to stay with them. So we need to understand that, you know, certain relationships which are there in our life, we should take it as they are given by the God, that's all. Like, you know, relationship with the wife or in a husband, relationship with the father, relationship with mother, relationship with father-in-law, mother-in-law, relationship with daughter, relationship with son, daughter-in-law, all these are actually it is a product, part and parcel of, you know, the we can say, you know, part of his karmic and part of his, like, you know, is orchestrated by Krishna for us. If we think that it is orchestrated by Krishna for us, then it will become very easy to tolerate. These relationships are given to me by God. Doesn't matter whatever form it may, you know, whatever color and form it may show, I am going to accept it. When you see this way, actually, when you see the hand of God behind these people, then you'll understand that, no, it's okay. It's okay. And no, a lot of realizations will come to these people also, that, no, though I am, actually, Krishna will give so many realizations through these people. I'll tell an example upon this matter. That, you know, we'll understand that how actually our life is very temporary and very short, and we are living with these people for pretty very short time. And within this short time, we cannot, you know, have issues with them and block our mind, which is for these petty matters. So it is very important to understand that, no, we should not spend time upon that, but rather have a focused approach of our life. What is the focused approach? Is that, no, my life is not meant to get absorbed in, you know, this kind of other things. My life is meant to develop my relationship with Krishna and develop devotion to Krishna, perfect my life and go back to Godhead. Else, again, I have to take birth in a similar kind of situation. Whatever the subtle body we frame in the current life, and when we are living the life, we'll be living with those all the subtle body. And when we take birth, Krishna will give the entire material nature is designed such a way that you will take birth in the next life, wherein similar kind of situations are again, you're placed in similar kind of situations. So do you want to again go into the situation, or you want to go into a situation where actually you're happily serving the Lord? Is what actually your focus has to be. And I'm telling that, no, sometimes we need to tolerate, we need to forgive and forget. And this will come actually if you have love towards at least one person who is actually pure at his heart. Even if you have one loving relationship in your life, that will actually compensate for all the negative energy which is present in and around you. One loving person should be there in our life who can actually render, you know, who can actually lend a shoulder to you at any point of the time when you actually are in depressed. Actually, honestly speaking, most of the people in the current generation, they do not have even one loving person to share their heart. I'm telling you, that's, you know, very, very sad state of the affair. Earlier, actually, you know, in the olden day ages, there used to be people like, you know, grandparents. There used to be like, you know, who used to be like, you know, saintly people with whom you can go and discuss. But no, nowadays, we don't find that kind of this thing. Even the grandparents are also actually, you know, they get irritated when you actually discuss all these things, because they'll pour out their own problems upon you. They are not wise anymore. So actually we require, you know, somebody who is love and genuinely representing the teachings of this Bodh Gita and Bhagavatam. Even if you have won that loving relationship, you'll be able to overcome all the negative things. So my request is that please continue to come to this kind of classes, and you will definitely feel inspired by at least one person in your life. And you should assume that, no, that is the person who is sent by Krishna for you in order to overcome all kinds of negative, or, you know, all kinds of difficulties of your life. And those difficulties, which were very big, they'll become like a hoof print of a calf to just very new, you can just cross over. Ocean, you'll feel it as ocean a difficulty, but same ocean a difficulty becomes a hoof print of water and a hoof print of calf. You can just cross over it. So that's the power of, you know, having a nice loving relationship with at least one devotee. So that's my answer for you.
Thank you, Prabhuji. One question is there in the chat, and one devotee also have raised the hand. What would you like to take?
Yeah.
One chat question is, please highlight about covetedness, Prabhuji. Covetedness, what you explained in this.
Coveted. Coveted means, you know, wanting to be in a center, wanting to be, you know, wanting to be the self, you know, so much you're obsessed with selfness, what I say, covetousness, how should I say, I want the first prize, I only want the first prize, I don't want anybody to get it. That's called covetousness. You extremely, you know, you're obsessed with that particular point. soul consciousness. Especially, you know, always you are coming first, second. No, one time you come fifth, now you will become so very disappointed. And next time you actually, you know, whole focus is on that only. That's called covetousness. Quite dangerous. These are all actually, you know, what to do. You know, our entire schooling system is done in such a way that, you know, we develop this covetousness. Actually, earlier Vedic system was such that no marks were given. There's nothing called marks in a Vedic system. You know, the guru is to evaluate based upon your consciousness. That is what is evaluation. That's all. No marks were given. Comparison were given. No. See, if you go by the evaluation wise, if we tell Yudhishthira Maharaj to, you know, shoot an arrow, he will not be able to shoot the arrow. He'll fail. Similarly, if you tell Arjuna to do, if you tell Bhima to do the, what you say, spade, throw the spades and throw the lancers, he'll not be able to do it, you know, perfectly. Bhima's strength is different, Yudhishthira's strength is different, Arjuna's strength is different, Nakula and Sahadev. So, in this fashion, if you go answering to your question, that no, the marks are not given actually. So, that's why there was no covetousness. Everybody is, you know, perfect, Indori, made perfect based upon their strengths and weaknesses. So, this covetousness comes because of comparative mentality. So, we need to overcome this and see that, no, Lord has created me for some purpose. And no, we should look what is the purpose for which the Lord is created for me and fulfill the purpose before we leave this body.
Thank you. One more question here. Hand is being raised. Lakshmi Mataji. Yes, you can unmute and ask.
Hare Krishna Prabhuji.
Yes. Hello. Yes, sir, please go ahead.
Yeah, Prabhuji, you were saying that we have to tolerate the relatives. So there are certain situations where the relatives try to mentally torture and try to gain control over you. So in those kind of situations, how do you deal with them? Should you still be friendly and tolerate, or how do you, or do you have an option to safeguard yourself from these kind of issues?
See, one thing, Mata, is that no one can hurt yourself. No one can hurt you, except yourself. Except yourself, nobody can hurt you. So that we need to understand. And the second thing is that you're telling somebody is trying to gain control over you. Unless we allow ourselves to control them, nobody can control us. Nobody can control us. You know, it is like, you know, out of force somebody does, we can always have the opportunity to tell that, we need to, remain at this particular level. You know, it is a little disturbing me. Express it out to yourself. My main majority of the times, what will happen is that, you know, we don't express ourselves, telling that, this is something which is causing problem to me. And I would like to restrain myself. Maybe, you are right from yourself. We should not tell that, you are wrong. When we tell that, you are wrong, it brings them a lot. We should tell that, maybe you are right from your side. But no, somehow, this is not accepting. My heart is not accepting for this. Maybe for some time, we'll remain little at a safer distance. So that, I'll not disturb you and you'll not disturb me. So in that way, actually, we can express it out, frankly and honestly. And third thing is that, I'll just tell you one example. This is an example of, two brahmanas. And it makes a lot of sense, actually. Thought I will share this with in the previous example also. That there will be one brahmana, he'll be going towards Tirumala. So what will happen is that when he's going to Tirumala, before that actually, one more person will be going in front of him. But what will happen is that this brahmana and that brahmana, they don't go well with each other. So the brahmana A will be thinking negatively about the brahmana B, that he is going in front of me. We do not know what kind of plans he is making about me. About the brahmana B, he'll be thinking like this. And when he was walking like this, he'll actually see one stone. And when he's actually approaching the stone will start becoming bigger and bigger and bigger and bigger. And when he approaches the stone actually appears to be so big that he actually blocks the entire path. It blocks the entire pathway. And he'll be sitting there and he'll be cursing that brahmana, that this fellow has done this work. He doesn't want me to go and take darshan of Lord Balaji. That's the reason he made this plan of blocking the entire road with the stone. Then he'll be contemplating like this. And what will happen is that at that point of the time, one old lady. She also wants to go to Lord Balaji. So she'll be going to that path, and what she'll do is she'll just, you know, kick this stone aside, and now she'll be, you know, moving. This Brahmana will be totally surprised that, you know, how is that, you know, this older lady, she just, you know, throw the stone, and you know, she's just going walking away. She goes, he runs, this Brahmana, he runs and to that older lady and asks that, you know, how is that you're able to, you know, throw such a big stone and, you know, just walking away and, you know, towards the pilgrim. Then the lady will tell that, no, see, the problem with you is that you are contemplating so much upon that stone, that the stone appeared so big, though it is actually a small one. So the problem is with our mind. With the mind, actually, we start contemplating upon the comments which are made by the other people. The comment becomes so very big that it actually engulfs our entire consciousness. So that is the reason we actually require a positive engagement all the time for our mind. When we have positive engagement all the time in our mind, then, you know, the criticisms and the comments which are made by other people will not actually touch us. Will not touch us. Even if somebody criticizes us, we'll become happy. It's good. It's good. I'll tell one more example of myself. Actually, you know, generally I take my car outside all the time. But no, one day I was, you know, driving my two-wheeler. There was heavy traffic was there, and you know, there was one Audi car, and you know, that Audi car also stopped, and you know, there was one small gap which was there, and I was trying to take my two wheeler from that. It was raining and I want to take it, so there was practically speaking only one inch of gap was there between the Audi car and my vehicle, and I was trying to take it carefully. When I was, you know, just crossing that car, the Audi car fellow, he brought down that window down and he shouted at me. You know what he said? You nonsense, you know, do you have brain? He spoke, you know, something, 3-4 words out of, you know, anger, you know, because out of anger, his words were not coming out of his mouth, and he was trying to blurt out all kinds of, you know, filthy words and all. Then, you're a fool, like that. When you said fool, na, what I remembered is that I remembered one lecture which I heard from Vedant Chaitanya Prabhu. I think you all must have heard Vedant Chaitanya Prabhu's first class. He was saying that, no, only an intelligent man understands that he is a fool. Then I think I need to understand that I'm a fool. I'm thinking that, no, actually I'm giving the remote control of my life in somebody's hands to control. I should not give the remote control of my life in somebody's hand. Somebody should not dictate my emotions, the way my emotions to operate. Let my remote control be in my own hand. Don't give remote control in anybody's hands. Your life's remote control should not go in anybody's hands. Somebody's words should not dictate the way you actually think. Your way should be dictated as per the scriptural guidance. Means you heard from this, from Bhagavad Gita classes, and you heard from the superiors, and you have gone through the books, you know, books like Bhagavad Gita. These principles should guide your life. That your remote control should be in these hands. Your remote control should not be in the hands of the outside people who actually try to trouble you. Don't give the remote control. Don't try to. Your mind should not dance as per the channels they are changing. No, don't allow that to happen. We should never allow that to happen. If somebody is telling me fool, let it be. It's okay. Yes, I'm accepting that I'm fool. Let's accept that point. I'm fool. Okay, fine. Thank you. And let's focus upon our goal. This is what I felt, Mataji.
Thank you, Guruji. One more last question is here. When the quest and search is on for the purpose of us, but how to realize and understand it that we are on the right track?
Yeah, that's a good question. So actually, there is acharyas have done, you know, great amount of research to say that, no, there are various milestones are there actually in order to, before we actually can understand that, no, we have reached the goal. There are various milestones are there, and there's something called process called anartha nivritti is there, and after the anartha nivritti brajana kriya is there. Then the stages are there, and the stages of total 9 stages are there, which finally ends up with the prema to the Lord, prema bhakti it is called. So, you know, maybe this is a very broad question. It can be discussed for a pretty long time, but I'm telling that, there are milestones which are there when you practice the, you know, spiritual path. And, you know, when you're actually applying this principle, you'll get a certain realization. And when you cross that realization, again you have to apply certain principles, again we get realizations. And all these realizations actually mention scriptures. So maybe, you know, once you come to temple and start taking the guidance from the devotees, they'll start guiding you and they'll actually tell that, no, you are crossing these phases and this is the next phase which will be coming up. So we need to observe that. That's how actually the quest for enlightenment will get finally fulfilled.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Guruji.
Hi, one second. Last question is there here. Somebody has just sent me. Yes, yes. So Ramya Mataji is there here. I don't know if she's really here. She is there? She is not there, I think.
What is name you said?
Ramya, it is there here. Yeah,
it's there.
She is there? Okay.
The name is there on the screen.
Yeah. How to set my mind to give first priority to spiritual life, then second priority to the duties when I need to perform like material things. There's nothing called material and spiritual mother. There's only one thing which is there, that is a spiritual thing. We need to understand that even the day-to-day activities can also be Krishnaized. There's nothing called, two tracks. It's not a railway track. Two tracks are there. There's only one track. Even when we are taking bath, we can remember Krishna. Even when we are brushing our teeth, we can remember Krishna. When we are cooking, we can remember Krishna. When we are interacting with our family members, we can remember Krishna. All the times we can remember Krishna. Rather, Krishna tells in Bhagavad Gita, tasmat sarveshu kaleshu maam anusmarayutyacha mayarpita manobuddhir maam ivaishacha ashtamshaya. Tasmat sarveshu kaleshu means always think about me. Tasma Sarvesh Kalesha, Ma Anusmara Yuddhacha, remembering me, Yuddhacha, you fight. By doing so, you'll never incur sin and you'll definitely come to me. That's what actually Krishna tells. So there's only one priority which is to be given in everything what we do, that is to remember Krishna. There's only one priority. You're dealing with a child, don't think you're dealing with a child, you're dealing with Krishna only ultimately, which is part and parcel of Krishna. So we are not dealing with any other person, any other thing, but we are dealing with Krishna only indirectly. So there's no two priorities, only one priority which is there in our life. So with this, I'd like to,
Yes, Prabhu. So I'd like to express our gratitude to His guest, Navadeep Gauram Guru. So Prabhu demonstrated by his own personal example, so many nice stories and practical day-to-day life incidents Prabhu shared, so that knowledge become more handy for all of us. So scripture says tamasoma jyotirgamaya mrityurma amrutam gamaya asatoma satyamaya. But how to do that? Bhagavad Gita gives us principle for all of us. And we have teachers and devotees like to present us so subject matter become more lively and more applicable for all of us. So we'd like to express our gratitude in our traditional way by loudly chanting Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna, 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 Hare Hare.
Hare Rama,
Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare.
Thank you very much, sir. Thank you for joining.